simply being able to bounce back. It's actually being able to bounce back better.
Thank you.
It's not just simply being able to bounce back. It's actually being able to bounce back better.
Are we live? Hello, good evening, everyone. This is the welcome to EMDRCM Live. This is the 14th episode of our series. Tonight's topic will be on sustainability reporting. So our main question for tonight will be, will incorporating resilience in sustainability reports make a difference? So we'd like to welcome you. I am AJ Villar from the EMDRCM Cohort 1 of the Asian Institute of Management. Now tonight with us, we have very special guests also from the cohort. We have Ms. Cheryl Joy Gutierrez and Josh. Hello, SJ for short. And then we have Jocelyn Carpio, also from EMBRCM. Hi, Jocelyn.
Hello, good evening.
Good evening. Hi, guys. So this is another one of our episodes. Before we go on and dive deep into our conversation, why don't you introduce yourself a little bit more? So maybe you can tell us about what you do and what got you into EMBRCM and DR and resilience in general. So maybe ladies first.
Sure. Good evening, everyone. I'm Cheryl, or SJ, as AJ mentioned. So I'm part of the Cohort 1 of EMDRCM. I'm an environmental planner by profession and currently a research and development officer of ADEC Innovations. So we work on platforms and on sustainability, especially on business solutions for different stakeholders, such as the governments, coalitions, and enterprises. So I've been in this business for more than 12 years, perhaps. I started with environmental impact assessment, and then 4 years ago, I shifted to research and development, focusing on sustainability. So for the past years, I've been drafting the sustainability report of our company and attending also conferences on sustainability, representing our organization. So there you go. So I got interested into the EMDRCM space or the resilience space because I do believe that the two are integrated or linked, sustainability and resilience. So if you're not resilient, then you can be tagged as being sustainable. So you have to be resilient first in order to become more sustainable. So that's it.
Okay, that's quite a lot of work, I imagine, that you've done. And is this why you got into EMDRCM, into DRR, studying in DRR?
Yes, I got interested into the program because even years ago, I've been looking into a program that would create such a massive impact into the society, meaning I want to get into a space that's really been reviewed, or a space that hasn't been gone by so many people, so that much impact could be created.
Thank you very much for that. How about we move on to Jocelyn? I'm sure you also have a lot to share.
Thank you, AJ. So basically, I'm a forester by profession. So I do specialize in social forestry. And currently, I work as a sustainability consultant to one of the oldest and largest conglomerate in the country. I think one of the reasons why I joined EMDRCM, or the Executive Master in Disaster Risk and Crisis Management, I think there are two things that comes into my mind. First is that the leadership and management identity of the AIM brand. So in my leadership journey, I understood that this would help me boost to achieve the vision I would like to see happen. But at the second time, as specializing also in sustainability, I see an opportunity where there would be a new thought leadership incorporating the two ideas. So both is basically with regard to opportunity, but first with regard to my personal leadership development, but second is to the possible impact that I could make in our society.
And I think that is exactly the meat of our conversation tonight. It's the thought leadership of merging the two together. Both of you have said that sustainability and resilience go hand in hand, and there is a very definite link. So for our viewers out there who aren't really familiar with sustainability, it's a buzzword, but if you ask the man on the street, what is sustainability? You get a lot of different answers. So what is it in the easiest way possible to understand?
So sustainability is drawing an impact into the three pillars of it, or the three spaces, the economy, society, and environment. So it's creating an impact into those three aspects of life, so that you'll be able to integrate everything, the operations, for instance, the operations of a company would become more sustainable if they involve, one, their stakeholders, if they produce a positive impact into their environment, or if they create more jobs for more people. So that's it. That's sustainable operations or sustainability.
Well, basically, absolutely, that's correct. I think the only thing that I would like to add is that in sustainability, it's simply managing today so that our future would not be compromised. I think that's one way of saying it. So that doing things in the right way so that our future existence, not only as an organization, but our community, our family, is not compromised.
Actually, it dates back from this sustainable development perception, wherein you have to use the resources that we have today so as not to compromise, like what Joshan said, the future generation.
Of course. And that's always very important, the future generation. Now, my question is, how is that related to resilience? Because resilience is all about now. Resilience is all about if we talk about resilience in layman's terms, not in BRR terms, not in what we study in class, but resilience is more of we can survive today. But that's a common misnomer. So maybe you can explain, how is sustainability linked to tomorrow? To resilience?
Well, perhaps I can start. Well, on the perspective of a private organization, I think resiliency is about being able to adapt on immediate changes in your environment, but at the same time, you're also able to adapt on the long-term changes in your environment without compromising your ability to give value to your society. So basically, when that's how I define a resiliency. So, but again, there are different layers of resiliency in the aspect of organizational level, there's also in the aspect of personal level.
Okay, well, you mentioned that, I think it was SJ who mentioned that sustainability will also focus on economy, society, and environment. And when you do sustainability reports, you take a look at each of those three aspects. Did I get that right?
Yes, it's definitely right. It means that as a company, you have to disclose the management approach of your organization in which you create a valuable impact to those three aspects that we've already mentioned, the environment, society, and the economy. How are we be able to give more value or to be able to continue our business in such a way that we're not creating a negative impact into those three areas. So there you go. And as mentioned earlier by Joshin, I beg to disagree that resilience is that resilience only focuses on the now, because as what our professors or from what our experiences have taught us, when we say resilience, it's also focusing on the future, because based on the thematic areas, we have the mitigation, the preparedness aspect, so one of which is the preparedness. So when you're able to prepare for the future, it's actually preparing for the worst. So you try to make your operations now more sustainable to be able to respond to the challenges that may occur in the future. So there you go.
Well definitely I agree, SJ, you know, that future is always a factor for resiliency. Moreover, it's also good that to emphasize that the changes that we would like to be prepared for are those that we see in the long term, but at the same time, and the changes that could happen anytime. So I think that's a dual perspective that we could strengthen when we view about resiliency.
So when it comes to thinking about an institution's sustainability, we think about the now, our actions now, and how it will affect tomorrow, and how it will prevent further impacts of disasters to the company. Tama ba? Yeah?
Well, I think let me build up on that. That's a good starting point. I think for an organization, it's no longer just about natural disasters. I think the world that we live now is very complex. We have the policy aspect. We don't know what would happen in the terms of the policy where you belong. Second, there's also an internal concern. Third, we have now the growing cybersecurity issues. So as the world becomes complex, these changes that might affect our ability to give value to our society is one thing that we should look into, and also what the future entails. And again, one of the concerns in this complex world, it's just very volatile, it's very ambiguous.
Yes, true. And to add to that, when an organization reports its management or its approaches, it's like being able to become more transparent. And in transparency, you get to involve more stakeholders in the process. So they have a stake to the what's now and also to the future. So with regard to resilience, it's also the approaches or the strategies being currently conducted by different organizations and companies when it comes to pandemic. It's the major crisis that we have right now. So it's still part of the business continuity of each and every organization.
That's a very good point I'd like to go follow. You said, SJ, and maybe you can also add Joshua to that, is that the transparency is the main goal of the resiliency reports, and it's for the stakeholders to add on to or to base their actions on. How do stakeholders affect an institution's resilience? How does that flow into the action of your institutions or the institutions you work with?
So organizations create an impact to both, if I may say, the internal and the external environment. So what you're saying, or what I've mentioned earlier, were the stakeholders, and these stakeholders form part of the external environment. So we respond to their challenges because we are also responsible or accountable to the people around us. So they are part of our society. So I've mentioned earlier, whenever you make an impact to those three, the environment, the society, and the economy, then you create that transformation effect.
Okay, Joser?
Okay. Actually, to build up on that, the sustainability reporting field has developed through the time. So there are different standards being developed, there have been different frameworks, and they have different recommendations given. So I think what we think that we have learned in the sustainability reporting is that the involvement of who are your stakeholders matters, but there's also growing aspect. Like, for example, the question we need to ask is that, what do investors value with regard to companies? So there will be your standards on how to report sustainability. And when the good question comes with regard to climate change, like how do climate change would impact your opportunities and your risk as an organization? And that's a different set of a disclosure. So I think one thing that we can learn on this evolution of sustainability reporting is that as the society changes and the demand to disclose new information from different stakeholders also affect what organizations disclose in their sustainability reports. And I think one of the, with regard to resiliency reporting, that's one thing that we need to focus on. Because when we ask a question, what do information do organizations need to disclose with regard to resilience? How they should report it? And to whom they should target it? And what is the framework that they should follow to ensure proper disclosure of resilience? And I think these kinds of questions has not been answered yet. And I think this is also one way as EMDRCM can also be a thought leader to develop such kinds of guidelines to help different kinds of organizations to disclose their resilience information.
So what I'm getting is that there's no standard of what a sustainability report should look like. There's no, these are the parts. Like
there are various frameworks actually available in the market or globally.
With regard to resiliency reporting, there's no clear guidance from it yet. So we disclose risk management, we disclose part of our business continuity. But the clear standard that we would put organization on the same benchmark, there's no clear yet. And I think for us as EMDRCM students, especially with SJ, we've talked the previous day, this is one of the opportunity where we could flesh out, like to provide guidelines for private organizations and different guidelines for our non-government organizations. But I think one of the important thing that we should also address is that it must be a multi-stakeholder approach where we try to think that what do the stakeholders want to know, what information they must know, and what information is relevant today. And there must be a value creation in that mechanism. Why do I'm saying this? Because we'll always get to the point as an organization or an individual would say, what is it for me? And I think this is the work of leadership that we are also positioned to work together, is that to create this mechanism or system where we can incentivize transparency and resilience that would give a better value for our stakeholders, for the investors, for the insurance companies, for the bank sector, and also as a private organization.
Okay. I'm really curious because, of course, these are in broad strokes very very good ideas.
But now, if I may add, you know, AJ, just to clarify, I think because of some of the terminologies too, to add on what Joshin said earlier. Did you know that most of the chief finance officers, according to some studies of the World Economic Forum, says that they prefer sustainable companies over other companies? And in current survey or studies also conducted by some institutions, the ESG or the Environmental Social Governance funds, which also pertains to or reflects the sustainability investment, has risen to about 12 million in the first 3 months of this year. So it shows that the companies are gaining more traction into this field, or they're creating more noise in developing reports that would disclose their current operation, at the same time, the kind of impact that they create to their surroundings or their environment, to the economy, the kind of jobs they create, the kind of lives that they are or dreams they're able to fulfill. So it all boils down to the right. Actually, there's no right form of reporting as long as you tackle those three aspects, because there are so many frameworks out in the market, and the globally recognized one is the Global Reporting Initiative Framework. However, as Joshin mentioned, there are just certain portions of resilience that are being reported by some organizations, such as the risk, as mentioned by Joshin, and also some disclosures on their business continuity plans. But with regard to the development of a resilient organization, it's not completely being detailed in these sustainability reports. So it's very timely that as we progress in this pandemic stage, we get to create an organization that is able to bounce back in this business that somehow negates the negative impact of pandemic, but also creates a valuable contribution to those three aspects: the environment, society, and the economy.
It's that's a very interesting avenue, no, to talk about. Have you seen, like, we follow the news, we've been looking at the pandemic with a magnifying glass. What institution or what company have you seen who actually display these qualities of a good, sustainable, and resilient organization? Can you give examples? Maybe Joshin or Esrae?
For sure. But I think Joshin has more companies that could be disclosed with your question. But as for me, the adaptation of different companies depend on their vision and what they're trying to create. So there are different adaptation mechanisms. So as long as you make the challenges as long as you turn these challenges into opportunities, then you're already creating a massive change for your business. But there's also the Ayala, and I think Joshin could elaborate on that.
Actually, that's a good question, SJ, you know, with regard in this crisis. So I think one thing that we should also start with is that most of the businesses or organizations started with an assumption that this kind of pandemic will not happen in its lifetime of entirety. And when we talk about resilience, it's about asking resilience to what? Resilience to storms, to earthquakes, to insurgencies. So, and with regard to different companies, they also operate in different sectors. We have the airlines, we have those people in the hospitality group, we have those people working on a technology group like SJ. So I think the big question is to understand, is resiliency to what? Is it resiliency to the present crisis? Or are we talking resiliency to the possible that could happen? there are those two things that we cannot say that the winners today, or say be showing signs of being a winners, could really be winner at the end of this. Because at the end of the day, there's still some future that very vague and ambiguous to us. But I think instead of focusing on who or what organization, I think we should focus on what are the characteristics that I think at this time would be very valuable for organizations to thrive in the future. I have two things. First is the aspect of innovation, meaning it's the constant reinventing of who you are and how you provide value to the society. That's one. So before pre-COVID, they have their business as usual, but after this, during this crisis, is now they have to rethink and they have to be very agile. The second aspect is with regard to collaboration. As organizations become complex, it's no longer about being about me or about myself, but it's about creating relationships and linkages that now creates value. So let me give you an example. For example, an organization can focus itself beating others by, taking over all their customers, taking all their great suppliers. But there's also another strategy where you could work with people in your industry, people, your suppliers, and your customers to create a better value. So I think these two aspects would be, or principles, are the things that we should look into organizations, and that might help them to survive this crisis and future, meaning to be resilient on the possible things that could happen in the next month or in the coming years.
So if we are going, I really like the idea of having innovation and collaboration as mainstays in as standards for a company's resilience and sustainability. So the question is, will these two be part of your recommendation to be included in sustainability reports down the line? Like you said, there's no standard, but if there were gonna be standards, if you, either of you, have the chance to define the industry standards of sustainability reporting, would there be others that you want?
Well, basically, that's on the resiliency reporting. I think that's a good starting point. But currently in the program, we're also working on our capstone project. First, to define where do our organizations in terms of resiliency. I think the very important thing first is to determine where we are right now. So I think there must be a common assessment. As SJ always emphasizes to me, it must be focused on the context of the organization so that we will not put organizations on a standard that is unfair to what they are currently doing. So I think with regard to resilience reporting, it should not be looked as something of a compliance thing, but rather more of a guidance to their journey to be resilient. And that is the work of leadership. And I think this is what I appreciate with our program, is that it doesn't focus really on being downloading information, but challenging us together to work together to develop new mechanisms, new tools for our society to be resilient and sustainable. And to be honest, this is really what I appreciate being part of this program, because I think one thing that we have learned here together is that we do not have the monopoly of the knowledge. So I think at this point, I may have this kind of recommendation, but it doesn't put me in a situation to not listen to what you would recommend, SJ would say, but rather showcase the collaboration aspect on this. So basically, let me just summarize those two things. So first is really coming up first to understand where we are right now. That's very important. So we'll have a common standard for assessment. And second is to make it multi-stakeholder, meaning listening to different entities, people, organizations, and what they would able to say or their perception on this.
How about you, SJ?
So,
same question. What would elements be that you would recommend?
Okay, like what Joshin has mentioned, good thing that EMDRCM allows us or gives us the opportunity to rethink how we do things. So because of the thought leadership and the bridging leadership, we're able to first value the journey of each company and organization. So in the process, we're able to create this journey map. So it means understanding the journey of an organization, of where it wants to, or what's its vision, where do we want to go from here? How do you want to create an impact? And so from there, we have to understand first the current resources that we have. So it's a good thing that EMDRCM provides new tools for us to rethink those challenges and to come up with more innovative solutions in the process. So like it's coming up with a mental model, because before you're able to create a solution, you have to understand first the context and the challenges that you have to face, and the if a certain organization or a company is already equipped the resources, or if not, where to get them, or if there's a possibility for collaboration, as Justin have mentioned. So those two aspects are really important. The collaboration, I do agree with Justin, the collaboration part and the innovation part. And as we proceed in this journey, we also have to, there's this empathy that we have to resurface in the process of our reporting. So definitely the multi-stakeholder approach comes in. When we say empathy, it's like understanding the impacts that we create to other people and to the environment. Are we not discharging? Are we not contributing to the pollution that we have? Are we creating more accessible jobs for them? Are we retaining jobs in this field that we're currently in? So those challenges could be addressed as long as you try to understand first that the kind of organization, the context that you are in.
Yes, allow me to build with regard to resiliency reporting. Personally, this has been my some personal passion project. So during the program, it helps me through the requirements to refine this kind of idea, not also doing the report, submitting it for comments, but also sharing this idea with fellow colleagues in the class. So I think in the current development of this resiliency reporting would require for us to understand what must be reported and who are those stakeholders that needs these kinds of information. What information do communities needs to know? Let me give you an example. So for example, you're a hotel industry company, and then if you would ask with regard to resiliency, is to understand what do your communities around you need to know with regard to resiliency. So perhaps the community to ensure their safety and the employees that live there might require for these hotels to disclose what are your crisis management policy. So what is it something in your mind or you are prepared for when these kinds of, for example, flash flood would happen that would not affect us negatively? Or the community or the employees might ask, what are those preparation with regard to earthquakes that you are initiating to protect us? So when we start this conversation, allowing different stakeholders to share what they think relevant that they should know, there we bring a mechanism where organizations would see that sharing this information is not a matter of compliance. It is about gaining new value. So if this hotel group discloses now, okay, so my community, don't worry, if there's a strong that would happen, we have this crisis management policy. These would be the steps, and you could stay here immediately to protect you. And then we see there's a new kind of relationship building. And that's what we want to see, that resiliency reporting, even though we don't have it, that's the kind of vision that this tool would like to make. So currently, we're still brewing the idea and contemplating. And for our viewers who are into sustainability, health and safety, or perhaps on other industry like information technology or the hotel and hotel industry, or those in the engineering side, I know you also have some valuable insights with regard how to make organizational resilience. Please do reach out to the Viber group so that our program team can connect you with us. We could set our Zoom meeting and perhaps start this discussion rolling. Because I think together, by sharing information, collaborating together, we can create or snowball this kind of idea. So basically, the goal of resiliency reporting is basically to create a transparency to ensure resiliency of your, of not only of your organization, but of those stakeholders to you, right? Your investors, your insurance providers, your suppliers, your employees. So that creates new meaning.
So you know what? In our classes, we were asked to write papers on our aha moment. And that was just our my aha moment. So tell me if I understood it correctly, but resilience reporting is really not about standards and this is what you should put or this is what you should put, but more of showing value to our stakeholders.
Because creating value.
Creating
yes.
value to our stakeholders na, hey, we're taking care of you. You know,
giving
that
more accountability, that's true.
So, like, I think, I don't know, we have some classmates who work in industrial parks. So, if they create a resilience report on the safety of their industrial park, it will be really for their employees. Tama ba?
Right. And not just employees, no? It's also building credibility. So, if, for example, if I am the investor and I sue both of your organizations, both of you were the CEOs or the head or the executive in those organizations, and then you would tell me, oh, hey, Josren, this is how we disclose information with regard how to be resilient. So don't worry if there would be super typhoon in the Philippines because we have this relationship with the community. We are well connected with the local government. Our business continuity plan is well aligned to their public service continuity plan. We have this protection for our employees. And for me, as an investor, it only shows that economically, you'll be viable in these uncertain times. But at the same time, I know that why I am investing creates a long-term impact to the society. Mm-hmm. And I think this vicious cycle of value creation is really what we would like to see. So I think this idea of resiliency reporting, we should snowball this idea and start creating a prototype of this. What do we mean by prototype? Meaning, perhaps we could start writing some of the principles or ways that organizations should disclose with regard to resiliency, and come up with public consultation. Because at the end of the day, what I have in mind, what other people have in mind, will not be the final, or we would say correct. But rather, it should be on a process where all the interests of relevant stakeholders are being heard to and being packaged as a tool, which is this resiliency reporting. For this kind of resilience and sustainable communities and organizations that we would like to see.
And not only for the investors, if I may add, also to our the employees, our colleagues, the suppliers, the clients, because once we take responsibility of our operation, of our actions, it's diminishing the negative impact that we produce or we create to the environment. Like what you said earlier, AJ, once you're a safety officer and you take resiliency seriously, then you negate the possible or the potential disruption in the operations, like creating that unwanted discharge or perhaps preventing any leakage. So it's all part of retaining your operation sustainably.
Right. And I think one thing that we would put into is we don't operate as a vacuum with regard to resiliency. So let me give you an example. So for example, I am a retail industry. So basically, pre-COVID, people would go to my my store and buy what they need. But in these times, going to the grocery would increase your exposure and perhaps compromise the safety of others. As an organization in resiliency, I think you should not only think that focusing on yourself, but you should also start thinking together with your customers, with your suppliers, your local government, so that you can create a coherent policy and some guidelines. Because at the end of the day, there would be an interrelationship. Like for example, if you're an organization simply focusing how to make your groceries to be viable, considering the government or your suppliers, and then you might find yourself working on a plan that is not viable. Because simply it started with that assumption that you work in a vacuum. And the world that we live doesn't work like that. We are all interconnected.
So it's really impossible if you think in a vacuum and these are all the ideal ideals, and then suddenly you throw in the real world, and then
yeah. Actually, it's a journey. It's a journey from the I to we.
Mm-hmm.
That's how you create the value through sustainability and resilience. So it's driving an impact not only internally but towards to the community that you're engaged with.
To add on that, if we would like to see on the pre-COVID situation is that yes, we do have business continuity plans. We do have some organizations, we have some pandemic plan, and then when the pandemic hit, we then all realized all of our plans cannot be executed simply because some of our assumptions, some of our considerations does not take into the interest and the value of other stakeholders would do. So when the COVID hits, it also gave us a eureka moment that each organization, NGOs, private organizations, and other people organized started to do their things on their own. Diba? So let's roll out this plan, let's release these resources, let's buy more, let's protect these assets, and ending to a zero-sum game that one action creates value to others but decreases the value to others. One good example is with regard to face masks. So one organization might say, all right, COVID strikes, with our pandemic plan says we would buy a lot of face masks without working with suppliers that, hey, we have this plan, so please expect that when pandemic hits, please do increase your supplies, perhaps to double or triple to your regular thing. So I think here, collaboration is now one aspect that we would like to highlight.
Okay, just a little break. So for those who have just tuned in, welcome to the AIM EMDRCM Live. We are talking about resilience in sustainability reporting. So if you have questions to our guests, SJ Gutierrez and Jocelyn Carpio, they are both experts in sustainability reporting. So just type in, we are live on Facebook, so just type in your questions in the comments and I'll read away. Now, just another question for the uninitiated in sustainability reporting. Is this only for big companies? Is this something that SMEs and MSMEs? Is this something that they can do, or is this something that will add value to their operations, to their organizations?
Yes. Yes, it's not only for large corporations, but the SMEs also have a big role to play in this kind of space in terms of reporting their current impact. So there, it's not really on a one-sided or just a one big pie that you have to deal with, but also there are certain organizations and even the NGOs. There are NGOs that report or conduct a scrutiny of their operations on how they impact other people, their environment as well.
Are these only transparent? Like, is there a place someone can go to just browse at the sustainability reports of people who publish?
The frameworks are available online, but there are also trainings that you can check out on Global Reporting Initiative. There are some institutions that provide them such kind of trainings, as well as you can browse the net. There are several frameworks like SASB or the Sustainability Accounting, and then the Task Force on Climate-Related Disclosures, and then the Integrated Reporting. These are all frameworks that we could use as long as we are able to commit our disclosures and to report on the progress that we have on these aspects.
Okay. You know, it's interesting because we have a lot of guests. We have guests from Sulu State College. We have someone from the Division of Aklan, Malinaw School of Philippine Craftsmen.
Hello. Will Craft.
We have...
Hello, good evening.
We have Miss Beth Miliana saying that empathy, reliability, innovation, flexibility, and collaborations contribute to resiliency and sustainability. That's something that we have discussed in detail today. I'm looking at what we've talked about, and we've covered how sustainability focuses on economy, society, environment. Does this mean that resilience reporting is a subset of sustainability reporting? Or is it two different?
I think one thing that we should also start to focus on is what could be the easy way for organizations to adapt. So I think focusing on frameworks might be focusing on more of the processes. But I think at the end of the day, the thing that we would like to focus is on the question, what do these organizations think would be the better or best to do it, but at the same time, they see best for their stakeholders. So it might be an integrated one, it might be a separated one, or it might be just a simple section in their sustainability report. But I think the thing that we must achieve is what would be the interest of the organizations with regard if they would like to adapt or take leadership on reporting on resilience.
It's actually exhibiting good governance or leadership. Whenever you take accountability of something, or the kind of impact that you produce, it's holding yourself more accountable, and in the process, increasing also the good reputation of your company and engaging more investors or more clients to go to you instead of to the other companies, because you're now creating a value. You're now connecting the different stakeholders in your surroundings or in your environment that tackle this these challenges, perhaps.
You know, I think the value that you're also showing is interlinking the stakeholders. So it's not just you and the stakeholders or you and the stakeholders together, but it's stakeholder and stakeholder and stakeholder and you, and it becomes one big community where you can all bounce back and grow from each other, you know. We have a shout out. Hi, yes. Vincent Pass
from Hi Vincent
2019. Hello.
I think just one last note. I think there's always there must be always a caution when our goal is to reinvent the wheel. I think at the end of the day, it's not always giving organizations new standards, new ways, but rather to focus on the vision and let the process on how to do it adapt as these organizations or these stakeholders interact. So I think we need to focus on the vision that we would like to attain and not too much on the how-to, because the how-to would be determined by this interplay of interests and expectations from different stakeholders.
Yes, definitely true. It all boils down to who you are, the vision, yes. And where you want to go to. Where do you want to drive your organization? How much impact you want to create?
Yeah, so again, I think the point here is that there's still no guidelines on this yet. So if one of our viewers would like to help us, to work with us, to flesh this idea, or perhaps you might have some resiliency idea with regard to the state universities you're working into, to your people's organization or NGO you've been pushing into, feel free to connect with us via Viber. And our team would connect us and set us a meeting and try to flesh this idea and perhaps how this program might be perfect for you to attain the vision that you want.
Yeah. You know, this is really the core of our course. It's really creating those linkages with people who want to make a change, who want to be leaders.
Yes, yeah. True. And we need more people to be on board to this journey that we call resiliency and sustainability. Because we need more hats and more expertise. Hats. Yes. We need more people wearing different kinds of hats to flesh out these insights, to create more value and innovate the process that we're going through, or to create more tools in order to develop more sustainable and resilient organizations.
Yeah, go ahead, Josh, right?
So I think in this present situation with the COVID, this puts everyone on the same perspective that resiliency or organizational resiliency is the next big thing. And it also put now on focus on the ideas and thought leadership on how we could build back better, as we say, in this situation. So I think one thing that I would appreciate much, especially with our viewers today, for where you are right now, you have valuable lessons that is really based on your experience or based on you have learned in your academic institution. That would be valuable. That's a starting point. And now we started with the pre-COVID, now on COVID situation and the post-COVID. And everything that we have reflected or those aha moments would be very important. And if you would like to share that or have some questions or might ask, how can I make part of my organization resilient? We would be gladly to set a time. Me personally, just send a message to us or a comment, and then the team would be gladly to set a short discussion with you to flesh those ideas.
You're always welcome to have these discussions. This is such a good community to share ideas. That's why we have EMDRCM Live every Friday. It's because we have so many different topics. Just the other week, a group talked about the hotel industry. Some of our classmates in the hotel industry shared their ideas. So like for our viewers out there, if you have any questions or comments or ideas that you want to really in hands, you can send us an email at emdrcm@aim.edu or at tinyurl.com/emdrcmlive Viber community. Our facilitators here over at the AIM chat group below will be posting those links down in the comment section. So again, we welcome you and we'd like to thank our guests today, SJ and Josserin. Such a good conversation about sustainability and resilience. And you know, this is such a very foreign concept for a lot of people, and you made it very understandable. I hope that a lot of our viewers also had those aha moments.
Thank you for having us. Oh, we're glad that we're able to share or impart our knowledge or the things that we've learned from class or from our past experiences. So there you go. We welcome more ideas, perhaps. So if you could just type in your comment or go to the pages that AJ has mentioned, then yes, we'd be glad to answer them.
Correct. I think such questions are the things that we want, because good questions even allow us to be enlightened on new things. So let us keep asking good questions or even hard ones. Just send it to us as a comment. We would be glad. So I think what this episode has taught me, or in our conversation, Esther and AJ, is that what we have really expressed with our viewers today is that this program doesn't prepare us to fit on a simple box-minded, but rather it's a transformational journey. I have never imagined myself that I'll be this way on how I think, I relate, or even the way I relate with people. So I think this shows that this program helped us to integrate different, we have learned from the experience or the academic, but at the same time, be integrators, meaning this equip us to engage with different stakeholders with different perspective and bring them together, and together we could create some value. And I think we have clearly, I think unconsciously, been able to reflect that. I think how SJ, our experience in sustainability reporting, and how we have seen this idea started as a little fire and then go spread like wildfire all over the globe. And such ideas allow us to integrate this to what could happen in the area of resiliency. And I think that's very valuable. It's not something that we could download from a professor, but rather it requires training and mentorship from excellent people that chiseled us to be like this.
Excellent people we have guiding us in the EMDRCM course. So I'm also, like you, I'm also very, very happy with how we're learning and how we, the leaders, are becoming integrators.
Yes, so because sharing is caring.
Sharing is caring. Thank you, SJ. Yeah. I think that is all the time that we have for tonight. Thank you again to both of you, to our viewers. Stay tuned at the to the AIM, Asian Institute of Management, Facebook page for the next EMDRCM Live. We have many exciting topics for you. And if you have any suggestions, just pop it down in the comment section below and we'll be gladly able to accommodate. All right. Thank you very much. Good night to everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you. We'll be right back.
simply being able to bounce back. It's actually being able to bounce back better.